There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of your life. You're moving down the page.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt. I'm in getaway mode, heading off to Minneapolis, St. Paul, after today's show to moderate a debate among would-be Republican gubernatorial nominees tonight in the suburbs of the Twin Cities. Hope I see you there. It's sold out. You can't get tickets anymore. AM 1280, though, will be broadcasting it live, and Alpha Networks will be carrying it live throughout Minnesota, and so I'm hoping you will be tuning in. Microphone will travel to do debates. I think I'm headed to Arizona next. I would love to go to Colorado, but they no longer, Brian just hates me in Colorado, the general manager, so I won't be in Colorado doing that. In any event, America, I want to tell you that inflation, open the lines, Ben, 1-800-520-1234. The number one story in the world is Omicron. Now, the good news, remember my four square box. Every virus variant is either more or less transmissible than Delta, and it's either deadlier or less deadly than Delta. It turns out Omicron is far more transmissible. That doggone thing is moving fast. And a lot of people are getting it in America. Half the Browns have got it. Like eight Browns went on the COVID list. They should not play that game, by the way. They should cancel the NFL games where teams cannot play because that's not the product we're paying season ticket prices for. That's a product where three members of your offensive line are out and the Browns. Baker Mayfield could get killed and he should sue the league if that's the case. I mean, I love backups for one play or two play. And the Browns have the best offensive line coordinator in the world in Bill Callahan. And Stefanski is unflappable. He'll put together a plan. But, I mean, eight players because of COVID. So it's going everywhere. The Browns are looking around and saying, did you guys not get your booster shot? You know, you got to get your booster shot. They're playing in the season. They're 95% vaccinated. They're not scofflaws like, I don't know what Kyrie Irving ever did it. But let me try that one. I don't know what Kyrie Irving ever ended up doing. How's that? But it doesn't matter. This virus is going to break out. People are going to get it. I'm flying on an airplane today. I'll have a mask on. If I get it, I'll be fine because I've had two vaccines and a booster, and I'll be out for 2 days. That's really what it's not a problem. It's the original deal. It's a bad deal if you're not vaccinated. I mean, it's a very rolling with the dice. Run out and get your vaccination quickly if you're not, because it's going to be a punishing wave, according to the CDC, come January. Now, I know none of you believe the CDC, and I have problems. You know, I went online yesterday to find out for my daughter. How long after a child has COVID can they be vaccinated? You can't find that anywhere. It's a question millions of Americans are asking. How long, because my grandkids have all had COVID, and they were fine, by the way. They just got COVID, but they don't want to have it a second time because then they get quarantined a second time, and they lose another completely nutty amount of school time, and schools are closing. They're fine. Kids are fine when it's like a cold. But better to get vaccinated and not get quarantined. Now we're worried about the government. We're not worried about the virus. But you can't find that anywhere because CDC will not do its basic job. It will not. It's a complete bollocked up, complete messed up effort. Tony Fauci has messed it up. It's a complete and utter fiasco. You can't find that guidance. So I really don't. I can't tell her, and she's smart. She's looking too. How long after a COVID case, positive, tested, quarantine, does a child wait to get a vaccine? For adults, it's 90 days minimum. You don't get a vaccine for 90 days after you've had COVID. They don't give you advice on children. I assume they're different since they're getting half doses. But you wouldn't know it from the government because the government's got other things to do because the government's incompetent in every way, shape, and form, except the military when they use overwhelming force. Pfizer says its COVID-19 pill is likely to work against Omicron. This is great news. You get a symptom, you take the pill for 3 days, you'll be fine, you'll never get seriously sick. Has the government already approved it? No. No, of course not. They're going to take months to approve it. They're going to have advisory councils, and they're going to have weigh-ins from outside experts, and they're going to have to deliberate internally, and then they'll get around to saying yes after the fourth wave has killed hundreds of thousands of people. Way to go, FDA. The NFL has mandated boosters, but stopped short on testing. What the NFL should do, given that not only the Browns, but a half dozen other teams have had massive outbreaks and can't play there, they should cancel a week and see what happens. Because if we're going to go through the lunatic follies that we had last year, it's not the NFL. Play until March, but give people who paid money for a real NFL game their product. Story in the Wall Street Journal, which I'll come back to later. Millennials are supercharging the housing market. Why? They know that this 30-year money at 3%, some will get a little below 3, some will be above 3, is great. It's not going to last because the lead story today, the lead story everywhere, is that producer product index in the United States went through the roof in November. It did. It went up to 9%. U.S. producer prices climbed sharply in November. Prices that suppliers are charging businesses and other customers leapt. Not a word you want when you're talking about inflation. Leapt in November. The Labor Department said Tuesday that its producer price index rose 9.6% in November, the most since records began in 2010. Now, I don't know why the producer's price index is not what you're paying at the store. It's what the people who put things in the stores are paying to the people who supply them. So the people buying everything to deliver you a product got hit by a 9.6% year-over-year monthly increase. Okay, you do the math. If it was 10%, that would mean, oh my goodness, it's going to be 12% next year, producer price inflation. That means next year it's going to be 15% for you. And I've been asking you all week, because Joe Manchin has to hold strong. He has to say no to Build Back Better because it's a killer. Next year we're going to worry about how to kill inflation. And by the way, the Fed is meeting today and they're going to crush interest rates. They're going to maybe raise it a half point, the prime. And stocks will tumble, and gold will go up because inflation is... I mean, but do you feel this, producers? You people who are buying things so you can resell part, you know, the final product. 1-800-520-1234. Best call of the year I've had yesterday was Brian in Cleveland, who runs an 8-truck trucking operation, and he walked through gas, tires, and oil. He can't cut his driver's pay to make up. Has to raise the cost of freight. Cost of freight goes up. The people who buy the freight, whatever's in those boxes and mark it and put it on the floor, they're passing it on to you. I would like to know how inflation is hitting you, especially if you're a small businessman or a woman. I would love to know at 1-800-520-1234. It's early. I know you're going to work, but you're probably going to work earlier because you got to get there earlier, and you're probably not hiring the extra staff because you can't bring them on at the new wage. And besides, nobody wants to work. I really do want to hear from you. The good news of the day is Joe Manchin. Joe Manchin got caught by Manu Raju going to the car yesterday with Raphael Warnock at his side and got asked about Build Back Better. Here's what he said. I don't know what number it is. Don't ask me what number it is. It's Joe Manchin. It's Joe Manchin. Dwayne's been out partying at night with the band.
No. Just in general, there's still a lot of talk.
What do you mean you wouldn't say that when the president's not moving closer towards you?
No. I don't think I'm asking anybody to move. I want people to understand where I am, and I think that that's worth getting more of an understanding.
Which is where? Where are you?
Hey, you enjoyed this.
Wait, hold on. I want to know how you would answer something like that.
I mean, are you anywhere to the point where you could vote yes on proceeding?
I got to check with my pastor here. I can't.
You should check with the pastor.
I can't get in negotiations like this right now.
Did you hear that? He said he's checking with the pastor.
My pastor.
That means we're getting ready to pass. But anyway.
Oh! we go. I knew my pastor was wise.
Are you anywhere? I mean, they seem to think that they can change the rules and pass voting rights along straight party lines. Do you feel that way?
All my discussions have been with bipartisan Republicans, Democrats. Uh-huh. Rules change should be done to where we all have input in this rules change because we're going to live with them. Uh-huh. Because we're going to be in the minority sometime, then the majority back and forth. I think.
Listen, let me translate Joe Manchin for you. He likes Raphael Warnock. He's no dummy. He's been elected since 1982 in West Virginia, right? Joe Manchin's been winning elections since 1982. So he's got Raphael Warnock walking with him. I got to ask my pastor. It's funny. It uses up 30 seconds of the walk. He doesn't commit to anything. He's not buying Build Back Better. He's not going to get a voting rights change through. Joe Manchin, God love you. Everyone pray for Joe.
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
The Democrats know they're going to lose power in 2022, but that doesn't mean they want to remake the entire landscape of American politics. For whatever reason, Hillary Clinton is still doing press. And she's now saying the exact same thing that the left has been repeating, that Biden has repeating. Instead of governing the country, taking responsibility for your actions, you see, you could tell a leader from a follower, you could tell someone who actually has done something in their life by whether or not they take responsibility when something does not go right. Biden does not do this. Hillary does not do this. Obama never did this. Churchill did this.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
We all know everything is more intense when the climate is warming. Everything. And obviously it has some impact here, but I can't give you a quantitative read on that.
At least not yet, but he'll call the EPA and they'll tell him. Yes, Mr. President. Climate change spawned the tornadic activity we saw over the weekend. Yeah, and it was because it was 0.1% higher, and you know why? Because we drive too many cars. It's our fault. And you know what country is to blame for it all? It's America. It's not China. It's nobody. It's us. We're always the bad guys.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster families through an unlikely alliance between the Chinese government and a British footballer. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans. With unprecedented access across the country, this is a unique insight into the lives of the 90s orphans now driving the 21st century's fastest growing economy.
This story needs to be told across the world. At a time where there's so much negativity and cynicism, here's proof that a single leap of faith can change the world.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt Liebau for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, talking to you about inflation very quickly. Matthew in Florida, what about Build Back Better and inflation? What do you do, Matthew? Are you a retiree or are you working?
Good morning, Hugh. I'm working right now.
And so how's inflation hitting you? And when you see a producer price index go up 9.6% in November, what do you worry?
It killed my bits. You know, when I was buying things at 31 cents or now 48 cents. Some distributors selling a can of Coke at 58 cents. 75 cents doesn't cut it anymore.
What's your business?
Between.
What's your business?
I own a vending company.
I actually feel for you, man. That means everything's going up, right?
Every single thing. Gas, you know, and the only people winning in this are the big box distributors. I mean, I can go clean Walmarts out of Gatorades and Coca-Colas at, you know, 10 to 20 cents cheaper than I can get it distributed to me straight from Coca-Cola.
Well, let's go back over that. So you go buy their loss leader items. So rather than buy direct from the producer, where the producer price index is going up 9.8% in November, you buy it from a big box, which it's a loss leader, and then you go stock it in your store.
Absolutely. It's the that's the only way I've been able to keep prices down for factories and like things like car dealerships, where, you know, 56% of my sales go to their employees. Hotels and everything, I can sell them for $1, $2 for a 20-ounce bottle. But, you know, I've tried to keep things down for the factories, which is just this last week I finally, you know, I mean, when it's 58 cents, you know, after tax, delivery, and sometimes commission, 75 cents doesn't cut it anymore. You just can't do it.
Tell me something, Matthew. How many machines do you own?
About 60 to 70 machines.
Okay, and how much does a machine cost now? Because that's really your core investment, right?
It is. You can get a used machine for $2,500. New, it's going to be $5,000 to $7,000.
How'd you get into this business, by the way?
I had some family look out for me and just leave a small little bit of money behind, and I made a small $40,000 investment in a route that a gentleman had had for 20 years, and it looked pretty safe, and I just kind of built the business from there.
It's a fantastic business. My best friend, who's now moved down to Florida, Rob Ganeri, he was a wholesale distributor, and so they distributed to people like you, and they distributed to small markets, etc. They distributed to everybody, but you guys, if you can keep prices stable, you will get a steady stream of income, right? The guys on the floor don't stop buying the same amount of Cokes, or you don't sell smokes anymore, right? You're out of that business.
I had one machine, and I got out of that a couple of years ago in a local bar. I don't like that.
Yeah, well, it used to be Cokes and smokes, and if you're my age, if you weren't in the smokes business, you weren't a distributor, you weren't running vending machines. But now it's all like Cheetos. It's the Orange Food Group machine, right? That's what it is. I love the Orange Food Group. It's Doritos and Cheetos,
snacks,
and Tostitos. Yeah,
frozen foods.
Twinkies.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Orange Fruit Group. They can't put you out of business.
Into the fresh market systems and everything.
What are you going to put in there, by the way, when the Kraft food takes over the millennials? What are they going to want? Are they going to want, like, day-old raisin bread? What are they going to get?
They can't afford any of the good stuff. Everybody can buy the Kraft. You put the good stuff in there. They don't want it. It costs too much money.
Did the schools make you take out the candy bars and put in granola? Did you have any schools on your route?
I almost bought a college route right before the pandemic, but I went for factories,
some harder working
factories instead. And they boomed throughout. I was really lucky I did that because my hotels went straight nosedive.
Can you do little shots of bourbon in any of these? Can you get away with that?
I did see an alcohol machine at one of these hotels, but I'm not walking down that road.
Don't go down that road. Hey, Matthew, I appreciate, because everything, you just illustrated for my audience what it means when producer prices go up. When you go to the big, when the retailer is going to the big box store to buy what they put in the vending machine rather than buy it from the producer, that means producer prices are skyrocketing. Matthew, you are the call of the year. God bless you. Good luck. I hope everyone uses your machine. Put your machine as featured on the Hugh Hewitt Show. All right, get a label. Matthew Machine as featured on the Hugh Hewitt Show. It'll do good for business until the glass is broken. Don't go anywhere, America. I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Do the police have a disproportionate interaction with certain areas of city that are predominantly black and brown? Yes, and that's because of the crime. You know, you go where the fish are. Don't you want the police to be where the crime is highest? And I think Democrats do it because they know that if they can get 13% or so of the black vote, 13% or so of the vote, which is the black vote, angry, and convince them that we are the party of social justice, and those guys over there, Republicans, are the party of racism. They can get that large percentage of the black vote without which they cannot win. And I think one of the reasons they're doubling down on this kind of nonsense is because more and more black voters are rethinking their emotional, in my opinion, allegiance to the Democratic Party. Donald Trump got 12% of the black vote in 2020. He got 8% in 2016. That's a 50% increase. And he got 20% of the black male vote. Largely because of his economy, best economy for blacks in history, prison reform, doing something about the borders. And the reason that's relevant is because most of the illegal aliens who come here are unskilled, and they compete for jobs that otherwise would be held by people living in the inner city with high school or less education, and they put downward pressure on their wages. He also pardoned Jack Johnson, the first black heavyweight champion, pardoned Alice Johnson, the woman that had the very long sentence for a nonviolent drug offense. He did the Music Modernization Act. And some 5,000 or so blacks, mostly black men, were able to take part of his prison reform and have their sentences reconsidered and reduced an average of 70 months. So for all those reasons, Donald Trump increased substantially his percentage of the black vote. And so they're now doubling down on calling Republicans racist and calling the police racist.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Last night I traveled. My wife and I went to a rare, what they call dinner party. I don't tend to go to them, but this was special people. Anyway, we saw very, very few homes with lighting. and I said to her, I wish we had a picture of these blocks that we're driving through from 40 years ago. I'll bet half the homes had lights up or some other decoration. Do you know, among its other terrible, horrible, destructive consequences, secular society makes it less happy, makes it more boring, which is why so many people gravitate to excitement. Secularism is, as a general rule, a boring place to live. So people are bored, and they look for excitement. Religious people have excitement being religious. Yes, it's exciting to be religious. Did you know that? I know that, because I am. The amount of joy and excitement that my religious life brings to me is immeasurable, especially leading everything as my weekly Sabbath.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. Merry Christmas to all of you. Speaking of Christmas, Angel Tree and I want to thank this audience. You've just been amazing. And we need more amazing. I'd like all of you who have given to give the same amount. That's not ingratitude. That's simply the fact that I keep looking at these numbers and 1.5 million kids. And we are doing thousands of kids. $25 takes care of a child. And thank you. I can't see these screens. Leonilo L in California, up early, sent us $25 to take care of one child. Thank you, Leonilo. That child will eventually connect up with you on the other side and thank you. Jennifer in Virginia, $100. Four children taking care of Jennifer. Philip in Georgia, $250. Philip must be a Herschel Walker supporter. That's 10 children. I can do math. That's 10 children in Georgia being taken care of. Grant in California, 25. Kurt S. in California, 300. Hey, you think that's Schlichter? You know, Schlichter couldn't possibly tell anyone that he's giving money to Angel Tree that'll ruin his whole shtick. Right? Killer Kurt, the Colonel Kirk Killer, extra in Apocalypse Now. That's what he plays, right? When he's in the studio, he always plays the helicopter scene from Apocalypse Now before he goes on the air. That would probably be Kurt. $300 and I don't know how many kids that is. That's 10, 12 children. $25 will connect a parent behind bars with their son or daughter via a couple of presents, a Bible, and a note on Christmas delivered by an Angel Tree volunteer. Listen to our volunteer from South Carolina who wanted to remain anonymous.
These kids, they're special, and they didn't ask for this to happen to them. We've become quite a little family. We really have. And she looked at that tag, and she said, my daddy gave me a gift, and he loves me. It just means everything. It's Christmas.
It's Christmas, and you make it possible. If you head over to HughHewitt.com and go to the banner at the top and be as generous as you possibly can. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let me check the markets for you, brought to you by our friends at Birch Gold. It was another rough day on the markets yesterday. Inflation going to be a really bad day today. I'm not a prophet nor a son of a prophet. I don't know. But the Fed is going to raise rates. The Wall Street Journal reports this morning, Fed prepares faster end to stimulus, making earlier rate increases possible. They're going to just bring the hammer down because it's 9.6% at the producer price level. I'm going to get to you in a second, Lynn. You can tell us about it. 1-800-520-1234. 1-800-520-1234. The 10-year Treasury is at 1.438, and gold is at 1,768. Overseas this morning, unbelievably, Germany and France are up. Great Britain is down because COVID is ravaging Great Britain. Omicron is there. It's going up sevenfold today. It is way transmissible. It's like a cold running through a preschool. Good news is it's not a killer. Bad news is it could be if you have underlying infirmities and you don't have any vaccination or any kind of booster. You ought to have had a booster by now and it will stop. But if you're going to buy gold, you have to do it now when it's at 1768. I don't want to look back next year at 2200 and say, I'm sorry, $500 ago you could have done this per ounce. And you cannot do it at home. As the tax court ruled last week, an IRA that is physical metals has to be kept at a third-party depository, which is what Birch Gold operates. And that's now black-letter law, as we say in law school. Black-letter law means there is no and, if, or buts. You cannot do an IRA on your own. You need Birch Gold. They've got all the testimonials you could ever want. Go to HughGold.com to read about it and request the information kit. Easiest thing is to text my name, Hugh, H-U-G-H, to 474747. They will get it to you. Now, I haven't done a rundown because inflation is on my mind. I'm going to do it very quickly. Fed prepares faster end to stimulus, making further rate increases possible. There's a great Wall Street Journal editorial, the price of the Fed's delay. It really comes down to misery for everyone. U.S. producer prices climbed sharply in November. Millennials are supercharging the housing market. Omicron spreading rapidly in U.S. could bring punishing wave as soon as January. That's in the Washington Post. Pfizer says its COVID-19 pill is likely to work against Omicron. That's in the Washington Post. Facing COVID spike, NFL mandates boosters but stops short on testing. I usually do this in the first segment. So if you're waking up at 6:30 and you're hearing this for the first time, you're saying, this is how the news should be done. You do it in the first segment. You can always listen to that at Highly Concentrated Hugh, my first podcast of the morning, over at iTunes, Spotify, or the Salem Podcast Network. Boris Johnson proposed a draconian crackdown in Great Britain, and 99 of his Tory members said no, no mas. He needed across-the-aisle support from the crazy Labour Party to get this passed. People are sick of being told what to do. They know exactly what their risk tolerance level is. They know what the vaccines do. They know what the booster do. People like me who do not want to get sick, I've got asthma and I'm 65, I got the vaccines, I got my booster, I have not been sick, knock on wood, I travel, I live my life, I do not want people to tell me what to do. I will get a fourth booster when it's available. A lot of people do not, will not, no matter what you do, get a booster. Employers can either keep you or not keep you. It's up to them. That's their right, unless there's a collective bargaining agreement. Governments, Boris Johnson is learning, have got to butt out. Governments have no place in this among free peoples. The fourth COVID shot is likely to be soon available in Israel, wait for it, for the immunocompromised people like HIV sufferers, people with underlying diseases. The top doc in Israel says we're going to get you a fourth booster soon. Because we should be, I just read the Israeli news and you'll know what the good science is. Oh, this is a killer. Poor old Andrew Cuomo's had to give back the $5 million book deal that he got under false pretenses because he was using the executive staff and the governor's mansion. It was not long ago when Mr. Cuomo was at his peak. He should never have been at his peak. It was driven by a media narrative that was wrong. The 2015 nuclear deal is no longer sufficient for the reality of Iran in 2022, says the IAEA chief. They got to have inspectors or there won't be a deal. There's not going to be a deal. What there will be is an Israeli strike against Iran, except the United States doesn't want that. So, according to the Times of Israel, the United States is telling Israel we're not going to sell them the new tanker jets we agreed to sell them. Because Joe Biden, Team Biden, doesn't want Israel to hit Iran. John Kerry's against it. Tony Blinken's against it. Joe Biden's awake and he doesn't know what's going on. and the tankers can't refuel the jets, and so Israel is going to be vulnerable to the nuclear-armed Iran because they can't... And meanwhile, Team Biden has screwed it up with the United Arab Emirates. Now, this is little Sparta. UAE fought with us in Afghanistan. They fought with us in Iraq. They buy our weaponry. They started the Abraham Accords with Israel. They are our best Arab ally. They are a stalwart. They are little Sparta, as Jim Mattis calls them. They wanted to buy $23 billion worth of F-35s and drones from us. Team Biden has jerked them around, and now they say, no, Ma, we don't want those planes. They're going to go buy French planes. That's not in the article, but that's what I guess. Way to go, Team Biden. They can't. There is nothing they can't screw up. Whatever Trump did, undo it. Trump held down inflation, bring back inflation. Trump bought peace to the Middle East, let's bring war to the Middle East. Trump put Iran on its knees, let's hold up Iran and get them nuclear weapons. It's like day follows night. He had a plan for Afghanistan, let's run away from Afghanistan. He contained China, let's fuzz it up so they're tempted. Richard Haass has an article in Foreign Affairs today that we've got to get rid of this strategic ambiguity that Biden has reintroduced, or China's going to take Taiwan. You want to tempt Putin into Ukraine, you act like Team Biden. It's a disaster. I told you, I warned you. Trump was rotten on Twitter. He made you mad. He made you angry. He made you pull your hair out. And now we've got Team Biden and inflation at 9.6%. Lynn in Michigan. Good morning, Lynn. Tell me about Build Back Better.
Oh, good morning. How are you, Hugh?
I'm great. Thank you.
All right. God bless. And 2 points. Looking forward to some great football on December 31st.
You didn't tell Ben that, did you?
I did not. No, I did not.
No, you did not. You Michigander. You are like cicadas. Every 15 years, you win a football game, and you get very noisy.
You're darn right. We're going to enjoy it.
All right.
Anyway, you won.
You get to gloat.
All right. That's it. One time, that's what we said to the, and my son is a Ohio House Divided, and we said, come on, one time, let us enjoy it, right?
One out of 15 years, I can live with that. Yep.
There you go. Anyway, and my second point, on your angel tree, I think it's amazing. And when we raised our children when they were young, we actually took them with us and delivered the presents to the houses.
Oh, I had no idea that you were one of the volunteers. Thank you. That, you know, and then they see what they're doing, right? They understand. You teach charity. You teach charity.
Yes, and it was great. We took the gifts to the houses, and they actually took them to the doors, and they were, you know, probably 11, 10, 9 years old at that time, and it was a great experience.
Lynn, can I tell you a story? In Ashtabula, Ohio, my dad, Tank Hewitt, would drive around on Christmas Day with Grace Koch and Deffrey Hewitt and deliver food to the poor, and that's where he became generous, and I think I love these campaigns because I know that story. So you're teaching your kids to care.
Absolutely. And to this day, they are, my eldest is 43, and they are the greatest kids to ever.
Except they're Michigan fans.
Yes. and then, believe it or not, we are steadfast Lions fans, too.
Oh, well, well, the Browns beat the Lions, kind of. Someone had to win that game. It was the Browns, but God bless you.
I know. But anyway, to get to the point, I had to call on behalf of my brother, who he and his wife are retired and 74 and 67 years old. And last year, he's very articulate with his money and accounts, and he was $200 above his spending, you know, last year, and he is in the hole right now. And he is very, you know,
he's meticulous.
They get their groceries. They have not changed one thing. In fact, his car broke down. He cannot even afford to get it fixed right now. And he cannot believe it. In 1 year, he said, going to the grocery store, that's all they do, and go to the grocery store. Don't do anything outside but go to church and go to the grocery store. And he is $200 almost under since 1 year ago in his finances.
And that is because inflation. That's just inflation.
Yes, grocery bills.
Does he know that that's Biden?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
What'd you say?
Does he know that that's Joe Biden's fault?
Of course he does. That's why he told me I've been...
Well, he's a Michigan fan. I'm not sure.
Yeah, of course he is. Yes, he is. He is a Michigan fan as well and lives in Michigan, and he knows exactly where it is. And he said, please call on my behalf. and let them know that I am almost 200 monthly down, and just from the grocery store.
Lynn, thank you for that. That is what people are feeling all over the country, and you cannot, quote, spin it. Thank you, Lynn. For a Michigan fan, you were awfully cool, and I really appreciate supporting Angel Tree at the top of HughHewitt.com. ReliefFactor.com. Got to go to the airplane today. Got to get on that airplane, fly up to Minnesota after the show. Minnesota, going to moderate the Democratic debate, the Republican debate tonight. I got all sorts of tricky questions. Things like, did the Browns beat the Vikings this year? That's one of my first questions, because the answer is yes. How many yards did Baker Mayfield throw in that? Stuff like that. But I have Icarian Kirkman, Resveratrol Omega. I'll handle the plane. They're down. I'm ready for the day. I'm ready for anything. I'm ready for a long trip to Minnesota cold. D. White was here from D. Witt yesterday, and he said it's a long trip. You know, you got to beat into the wind when you're flying that way. And I just got to get out on Thursday because the snowstorm's coming. But ReliefFactor.com, $19.95, get you started. Take it like I do every morning. You'll feel better for it. ReliefFactor.com, $19.95. Come right back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Streaming on Salem Now.
¿Cuánto queda?
No queda nada. Que lo siento mucho.
Have you ever thought of going to seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
The Democrats are not interested in running the government. They're interested in running politics. They want to turn America into California, a permanent one-party state. Play cut nine.
People who I knew that I served with, who fall in line on the outrageous accusations they make, whether it's against Dr. Tony Fauci or pretending that what happened on January 6th wasn't an insurrection, honestly, they have hung their spines up on the wall as they walk into their offices. They have no conscience, they have no spine. And we are seeing the results of a party that has been taken over by a demagogue.
Taken over by a demagogue. Hillary Clinton predicts, though, that Trump is running in 2024, saying that Trump is going to run again. You see, the Democrat Party's on life support. Their voters know that the country's falling apart, double-digit inflation, borders are wide open. Our military has been completely gutted and depleted. Morale is at an all-time low. China is doing whatever they want. And whatever reason, they're trying to reorganize us by beating the drums of war, saying, let's go defend Ukraine's borders while we can't defend our own borders.
Keep up with what's trending.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. I want to tell you about what I did yesterday afternoon. The celebrated journalist Fred Hyatt passed away a week ago Monday after a brief illness in New York City. He was 66, graduate of Harvard. He was my boss at the Washington Post, where I am a contributing columnist to the paper of record, really, in the most important city in the world and one of the most influential editorial pages in the world. And Fred has done it for 20 years, and Fred was 66. I'm holding in my hand, if you've downloaded the Salem News Channel, you can see a booklet prepared on very short order, but the production staff said anything for Fred. Fred Hyatt may be the most beloved boss I've encountered in, you know, I've been working since I was 16, and I'm almost 66 for 50 years, in a variety of different places. And the people who spoke, John Hyatt, his brother, a extraordinarily sharp labor lawyer who I could tell just by listening to him you wouldn't want to be opposite of, Donald Graham, the former chairman of the Washington Post, Tiana Wang, the daughter of a Chinese dissident who's in a Chinese prison today, who, you know, moved me to tears with her story, Ruth Marcus, who moved me to tears because Ruth is a friend and she's the deputy to Fred, and the ache of someone who's lost one of their closest friends was palpable, and colleagues Becca Clemens and Christine Emba, younger members of the Post editorial team. The remarkable Rick Atkinson, whose book, The British Are Coming, is maybe the best book I've read this year. I haven't finished The First King of America, but The Last King of America, but Rick Atkinson's The British Are Coming was recommended to me by Debbie. And when George W. Bush was on to promote his own book, and he's promoting Rick Atkinson's book, and he and Fred were friends and colleagues from around the world. But I'll tell you what really got me. Pooh, Fred's wife, who I do not know, just introduced the proceeding. We were outside at the Kennedy Center, and it was Post-only people, and it was many hundred. And I'm like a second cousin once removed in the Post family, right? I've been a contributing writer for 5 years. Fred and I sparked it up a lot, but we loved having lunch. I would have lunch with him annually or semi-annually, sometimes with Ruth, sometimes not. And I'd talk to him on the phone, and we would disagree. I mean, sharply disagree. But Fred was the most fundamentally decent and loving and kind guy. I quit 6 different jobs because of editors over the years, from the Weekly Standard to the Washington Examiner to, back in the day, WorldNet Daily when it went crazy. I quit that. Yeah, I just quit. When editors go nuts, it's not that I disagree with them. It's when they're irrational. I just say, see ya. You know, I got upset with Fred, and Fred would get upset with me, but we would be fine because professionals and people who respect each other. What I didn't know is that Alex, Joe, and Nate, his 3 children, who are girl, boy, boy, Alex, lawyer, Joe, I don't know what Joe does. Nate's the philosopher. They each gave about 4 minutes. And I have a girl, boy, boy, roughly their age. And I thought to myself, Fred, you won. You're on the other side, and you're, in my worldview, he's on the side of the angels. And you won. You and Pooh won. Alex, Joe, and Nate, you could not ask for better words from 3 children than were delivered for Fred from his 3 children. From his friends and co-workers, his friend being Rick and a co-worker, Ruth being a friend and a co-worker. You couldn't ask for it. So then I began. I got there. Again, I know very few people at the Post. I saw Dan Balls, and I saw Fred Ryan and Jenny Ryan, who's the wife of Fred, and Jenny and I have known each other for 40 years since law school. So I chatted with a few people, but mostly I read the work that they put together. And Fred's piece on The Pentagon, written August 17, 1986, which begins aboard the USS Independence during a rescue operation. It's just brilliant writing. He was such a fine writer. He began at the Harvard Crimson. I didn't know him as an undergrad. I didn't know him actually until 5 years ago when Ruth introduced us. And Pentagon reporters are special because they actually know stuff. You can't get stuff wrong if you're at the Pentagon. They called him Boy Wonder. That was a revelation to me yesterday. But I just want to say, if you've got children, raise them up in such a way that when you die, and if there is a memorial service and there's more than the family there, they'll be able to say in complete sentences, with extraordinary emotion and devotion exactly what it is that their father taught them. In this case, that to disagree does not mean to hate. To be aware of two sides to arguments, sometimes three and four. To be decent in all things and generous towards all people. And especially, he's sort of the embodiment of Micah 6. Do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. I don't know about Fred's God, but he did justice. He would speak up for the oppressed dissidents of the world against every malevolent regime out there. And he would seek and do justice. Fred Hyatt, 1981 to 2021. A wonderful, wonderful man. So deeply missed. I'll be right back, America. Stay tuned to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Prison Fellowship's Angel Tree Summer Camps. Click on the banner at hughhewitt.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I'll have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I'm going to get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Relatively stable, but, you know, there's a reason that, you know, the best single best investment you could have made over the last 20 years?
Now what? Stock market?
Bitcoin.
Bitcoin. Yeah.
Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Bitcoin's gone up like 10,000%.
Well, Stephen, if you don't understand it, how is anybody else going to understand it?
Well, what I do understand is that these are alternatives to central banks and politicians controlling our money.
Right.
And I like the fact that there is, you see, the central bankers hate Bitcoin. They hate cryptocurrencies because they don't want the competition. Mm-hmm. They want a monopoly on money. And I love the fact that now you've got all sorts of different choices out there. I mean, I was at the bank recently at an ATM machine. Now you can get Bitcoins out of ATM machines.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
And the Democrats' approach to everything is the sort of low-calorie fudge. You know what I mean? It's like it's police presence, it's discipline, it's all the things we know. It's diet and exercise. And their thing is, but what if we reimagined diet and exercise? Well, there's 200,000 books on Amazon trying to reimagine diet and exercise. It doesn't work. It is. It's gravity. It's all there is. You cannot reimagine policing. You cannot pull back policing. You can't reimagine this stuff. It just is. And we won't face that. Half of society is not facing reality in many realms. Financially, you know, from a police standpoint, diet and exercise. It's just diet and exercise.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
But he knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified, you can't see it.
Collusion, you just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
Charlie Kirk Show.
And we're perfectly fine doing deals with charlatans like you, Joe Biden. So Republican parties have, the Republican Party, at least the base of the party, we're awake now. It has nothing to do with QAnon, whatever that is, or the big lie. No, it has to do with, you know what? We're not okay with the adventurous, endless wars in countries we can't pinpoint on a map. We're not okay with keeping our borders wide open and acting as if that is an act of diversity. And basically, there's Joe Biden kind of engaging in some nostalgia, saying, I miss when we used to be able to vote to move factories to Wuhan, China, 97-0. Like, no, those days are actually over. Now, of course, Joe Biden is acting as if he's just some sort of cable news commentator. He's the president of the United States, not wanting to take responsibility for anything ever, despite being the most unpopular president, at least totally in my lifetime.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
America, bonjour, hi, Canada. The only story in America, I'm Hugh Hewitt, is inflation, inflation, inflation. And the fact that the Democrats pass the Better Build Back Better bill, they will take what is already a major problem and turn it into an inferno. And Joe Manchin is standing strong. Pray for him. Dagan McDowell on Fox Business yesterday with Maria Bartiromo said this, cut number 15.
We are very close to double-digit wholesale inflation. Let that sink in and let that scare you, because it will be feeding into consumer prices for months to come. The Federal Reserve since March of 2020 has kept rates at basically zero, and you cannot have a functioning economy where real interest rates are negative. Expect them to move, and maybe move more quickly in terms of stopping the bond buying and raising rates than some people are expecting. One very disturbing thing, and then I will wrap up, is that yesterday the New York Federal Reserve released a survey of consumers' expectations or public expectations for inflation. Short-term expectations, say in the next year, rose to 6% for consumer inflation. That is a record high. And it also is twice the pace of wage gains. So once expectations set in for higher prices, those higher prices beget higher prices. That it's a confidence game among consumers. And this could cement inflation for not just months, but years to come. Certainly a concern for the central bank.
The Biden inflation is cemented. There is no way around it. The question is, how hard will it be to break it? The Fed is going to announce stuff today. They're going to have to raise rates. Right now, I'll plug andrewandtodd.com right now. They're a sponsor of the show. They are with Sierra Pacific Mortgage. They lend people money to buy houses, andrewandtodd.com. Right now, the 10-year Treasury is at 1.438%. So Del Rey and Avakian, that's Todd Avakian and Andrew Del Rey, if you call them at 888-888-1172, they can get you a good loan right now. That's not going to be an easier thing to do in 2 months or 4 months or 6 months, because the Fed is going to raise the prime. When they raise the prime, everything goes up, including the 10-year Treasury note on which almost all interest rates are based. So don't wait. Go pay more for a house now and save money for 30 years, because this inflation, I tell everyone, I've told you many times, our first home in 1985 cost 12.5%. And interest, right now it's 3%. That's 30 years, lock it in, and watch the inflation raise the value of your home. The millennials, the story in the Wall Street Journal this morning, millennials are supercharging the housing market. The generation that supposedly didn't want to buy things now accounts for over half of all home purchases. Loan applications, economists expect them to bolster demand for years. That's because they know when inflation is coming. Watch the market. Steve Wiseman on CNBC added more bad news to the inflation assessment. Cut number 16.
Two things about this story here. One, it's not just the final demand. It's that you still have inflationary pressures in the pipeline here. Intermediate goods, unprocessed goods. So there's no sign that the pipeline of price increases is easing. So that's going to still... And just a reminder that this whole thing started with producer prices being on the increase, and then that bled over into consumer prices. So the idea is that there's more pressure to come. The other thing, again, service sector inflation. You've got quite a bit of that. So that's another issue.
It means your restaurant trip, your gas, everything is going to be more expensive in a month and in a year. And it's all Joe Biden's fault, but it doesn't have to be worse. Kill Build Back Better. Chuck Schumer, kill it. Joe Biden, the president, won't talk to Washington, D.C. reporters because he can't. And I think he's infirm. I've told you that many times. So he did the oldest trick in the book yesterday, did a series of interviews with local reporters who are in awe of talking to the president of the United States and don't know that you can be both respectful of the office and direct in your questions. So he went on WHIO CBS 7 in Dayton, Ohio, cut 22.
With regard to the cost of food for everyday, that's another big area. People walk in the grocery store, particularly meat, poultry, that's where the prices are up a lot. And there's a couple things going on there. Number one, as you well know, over the last several years, a lot of the big operators come in and bought out the small producers and bought out the small the small guys who are moving it from the farm onto your table. And so, for example, Tyson, this last quarter made, I think, a little over $1 billion more in profit than before because they're able to raise prices. There's so few people to compete with. I'm urging the Congress to hold hearings as to the concentration of power in a few hands controlling the food processing side of the equation.
Does anyone know how absurd that is? You think Tyson's gets given their chicken? Does anyone think that if you're feeding the chickens feed and the feed goes up that you got to sell more for the chicken? The idea that it's, you know, Soviet-style command and control, that's just nuts. And it's also so haltingly delivered, it's alarming. Then the president went on to a Columbia, South Carolina station with David Strickland, WLTX CBS 19, cut number 23.
Well, look, I'm in the view. I got involved in public life because of civil rights and civil liberties issues, and coming from a state that was a good state, but had a lot of problems. I think that I'm not sure Joe Biden's visit is important, except to the extent that I think we got to come together. I don't think we can continue to be red and blue. I really mean it. I think, look, we're a purple nation. This is not about, I mean, we're all Americans. And I think if we and I know I got criticized heavily when I was running for the presidency and getting the nomination, even in South Carolina, which I did very well in thanks to Jim and others. But the whole notion that I said, I'm running for three reasons. One, to restore the soul of the country. Sense of decency and honor. Treat each other with respect. Don't talk to each other like we're talking to each other. Secondly, to build the backbone of this country back up. And that's the middle class and working class folks. You know, Wall Street, I'm not anti-Wall Street, but Wall Street didn't build America. Hard working middle class people built America. And unions built the middle class. And thirdly, I said, which I really got clobbered by everybody for saying, but I still believe it, we have to unify the country. Democracies cannot function long unless you can reach consensus. And compromise is not a dirty word. And so we got to get back to that, talking to one another, getting engaged like we did before. I just did Bob Dole on his deathbed, asked me to do his eulogy. Bob Dole was a leading Republican. But guess what? We disagreed on a number of things, but we were friends. We treated each other with respect. We got to get back to that. Democracies are in jeopardy if we don't start working together.
Actually, the president wasn't exactly candid about driving through things on 51-50 votes like he's trying to do on Build Back Better. And so we are a red and blue nation. Doesn't mean we're going to fall apart. The Constitution is very strong, but the president is not. Then he gave a speech from the White House to the Democratic National Committee. I'll play the start of it now and come back and conclude it. Cut 24.
Today, the right to vote and the rule of law are under unrelenting assault from Republican governors, attorneys general, secretaries of state, state legislators. They're following my predecessor deep into the abyss. The struggle is no longer just who gets to vote or making it easy for eligible people
to vote. Did you hear that part about we got to come together? Got to come together. We can't be a red and blue nation. So listen to the start of this again. Okay, so we go from the local affiliate in Columbia, South Carolina. We got to be all together in this. We can't be a red and blue. We need to be a purple nation. Then he goes to the DNC and says this.
Today, the right to vote and the rule of law are under unrelenting assault from Republican governors, attorneys general, secretaries of state, state legislators. They're following my predecessor deep into the abyss. The struggle is
all right, so the Republicans are going deep into the abyss, but Joe wants us to be neither red nor blue. I'll tell you, I'm worried about the next 3 years. We'll be fine. The Constitution is very strong. I mean, it's just that the Chinese are not sleeping on this. Head over to Angel Tree, the banner at the top. If you heard my caller last hour, it was like one of the most wonderful ads ever. She takes her children to deliver the Angel Tree gifts. You don't have to do that. Angel Tree will do all the work. If you just want to give and you just want to be a part of the work, listen to anonymous volunteer in South Carolina talking about the work.
These kids, they're special, and they didn't ask for this to happen to them. We've become quite a little family. We really have. And she looked at that tag and she said, "My daddy gave me a gift and he loves me." It just means everything. It's Christmas.
$25 takes care of a child on the 1.5 million child long list maintained by Angel Tree. Go to HughHewitt.com. At the very top, you'll see an Angel Tree banner. Click on it and make your contributions. For every $25, another child on that list gets Christmas. Thank you.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
I digress. So anyway, I'm watching CBS Sunday morning. They got a weather guy on there. Derek, let us see if we can find this. He says, well, these tornadoes that hit Kentucky and Arkansas and all these terrible, horrible storms and people killed in the candle factory and people killed in the Amazon shipping facility. Now, it could have been climate change, but there are reasons that it might be climate change, but here are reasons where it's not climate change. The guy was like standing there sort of tortured because you know he's being pressured. Is this climate change or is it not? And it's like, can you just deal with the devastation? I've been to a scene of a tornado destruction. I went to Greenberg, Kansas, a number of years ago. We fundraised for the victims there. It's unlike anything you'll ever, it's like Hiroshima. It looks like when a nuclear bomb goes off, like an atom bomb. The whole town, just all you see are trees, tree limbs. And it's just awful to watch, to see. And our prayers and our prayer for God's healing and comfort with so many people who are suffering. Can you leave the climate change crap alone, please? For just what? Why are you fixated, lefties, progressives? Here's Cut 11. Here's Biden himself.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands.
Kill him.
Jump.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
I told you the story of Obama first meeting Reverend Jeremiah Wright. We talked about that just a few days ago. In his book, Obama
talks about how he scouted around to find the appropriate church to join, not because, in my opinion...
Trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I want to remind you, Key City Capital is out there to help you through inflationary times with investments at fixed returns. Not an offer to sell securities. I don't know. You have to read the prospectus. Even qualified investors should be warned to read the investment. But I love Charlie Dombeck. I love National. I mean, I love KeyCityCapital.com, and I want to encourage you to go there, KeyCityCapital.com/Hugh, and judge for yourself. Judge for yourself. And I will tell you, if you talk to Charlie, I think you'll probably at least have him look at your taxes and maybe invest with him. And scores of you are doing that, even though it's a sizable investment and it's a long 5 to 7 year investment return. But with inflation coming, the business model of apartment complexes and distributed risk, but access to that kind of an investment for someone who wants to take a tenth of their retirement and put it into that, that's a good idea. That's a very good idea. You got to get in touch with Charlie Dombeck, KeyCityCapital.com/Hugh. Diana in Ohio. Good morning, Diana. You're on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Good morning. Thank you, Hugh. I listen to you every morning. God bless you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Yes, and please continue to play Mary, Did You Know? That's my favorite song of all time.
It is very good. The Haven.
Well, you love good stories, and there is a book in the works that you might be interested in. So write this down. The title is, the working title right now is Ripped, R-I-P-P-E-D, At the Roots. Now, it might be Ripped from the Roots. I'm not real positive about that second word. But it's about airlifts of orphan children who were lifted out of Greece and brought to America, and they were adopted by families who reached out to adopt orphans who were, you know, from war zones. And those children are long into their adulthood.
Well, that's the Greek Civil War right after World War II. Is that when they got them?
That is correct. That is correct. It has been discovered now some years back, and this story has been unfolding. They weren't ready yet to go public, but I guess they will now with the book. Many of these children were not orphans. They were stolen out of orphanages, but they had living parents.
Oh, my.
And it's a story you can't lay the book down. And I happen to know one of those children. And she never suspected that she, you know, that she was other than an orphan. But through DNA and through just little things that peel away in the story, it began to look like there was some fraud going on here. And I don't know how much I can say on the air, so I just look it up and start. It's still being researched. They want to be sure the story is correct. Ripped at the Roots or Ripped from the Roots. I personally know one of these orphans. She's now probably 50.
Has she reconnected with her parents?
Oh, my gosh, yes. She found out it was true. Her parents are very much alive, and they thought she had died. Because they lied to the parents.
That's not just a book. That's a movie. Okay, I will look for that, Diana. Thank you, and Merry Christmas to you. I appreciate it. I love, you know, callers call me up with book recommendations. I listen to them because they know if they listen like Diana does every single day, and they listen for 3 hours for 21 years, as used to be the case in Denver. I'm sorry, Denver. They're cutting off the third hour for reasons unbeknownst to me, and I can't. I won't be there for the third hour. But if you listen to me for years and years and years, I love the great book. In fact, I'm having an author on today who you may know a little bit about. Katie Couric is going to join me talking about her memoir, Going There. And it's a fabulous read. It's a fabulous listen. actually. It's an audiobook as well as a written book, and I recommend the audiobook for reasons that you'll listen to the interview when I have on Katie Couric. You'll know when you hear why I recommend the audiobook. And it's the perfect Christmas present going there. I would strongly recommend you get that. But I love getting recommendations. You know, we are a literate society, or we were. I'm not sure what we're going to be after Twitter grinds through the attention span of the millennials for another decade. It really is destroying the ability of people to read books. If they don't get that little endorphin pop every 5 seconds, a book takes a little bit more, but it gives a lot more back. I'll be right back, America. 1-800-520-1234. Gallagher is coming up to tell me to stop complaining about the Browns. How come I can anticipate his every comeback? Don't go anywhere. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Key City Capital.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
I told you the story of Obama first meeting Reverend Jeremiah Wright. We talked about that just a few days ago. In his book, Obama talks about how he scouted around to find the appropriate church to join, not because, in my opinion, he was a believer. I don't believe Obama ever was really a believer. Can't get into his head, into his heart, but I'm just talking about his actions, what he says. He was looking for a church to be connected, because think about this. This guy's from Hawaii. He doesn't know Chicago. But he wants to get plugged in because he wants to run for office. And he scouted around and decided the church that was the most connected, that would give him the best street cred, was the Trinity Church, headed by Reverend Jeremiah Wright. So he arranged to meet Jeremiah Wright. And Obama arrived early, and Wright was not there. So Obama starts speaking with Wright's longtime assistant, a woman who was a single black mom, and tells Obama that she has a son, and the son is in high school, and the son wants to be in the marching band, but unfortunately, his high school does not have a marching band. So she scouted around and found a high school that not only had a marching band, but also would provide free uniforms. So she told Jeremiah Wright she was thinking about relocating to the suburbs, or her kid could benefit from this opportunity. And she told Obama that Jeremiah Wright was trying to dissuade her from doing this. And Obama said, why? And she said, because Jeremiah Wright feels that he will lose his identity. That boy won't know who he is.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
I'm an avid listener, so I hear you.
So what's the difference between tyrant and police state?
I think it's just the power of the word. I think that people still do not understand the real danger that we face, the existential danger.
The reason they don't want to. It is not because I haven't used the word tyrant as much as you would like. And they are tyrants. There's no question. I probably call Gavin Newsom a tyrant. But there's no magic adjective or noun that will awaken people to the danger of the left. They are awakening. That's the reason Youngkin won in Virginia. People are awakening to how awful the left has made our schools, that it is a crisis of the first order to send your child to most American schools. You are robbing them of their innocence. You are injecting, as it were, moral poison into them. It is an intellectual wasteland. And they're learning only hatred of whites, of America. That's all they learn, how to hate. And a lot of Americans are aware of this. And that is what is backed by the Democratic Party. The Democratic Party has contempt for this country. Not every Democrat. That's the very sad part. A lot of Democrats love this country. They vote for people who hate it. That is the tragedy of the modern liberal. They're the useful idiot of the left.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. I knew Gallagher was afraid of the Browns on Christmas Day, but I didn't think he'd go so far as to encourage the NFL to put a dozen Browns on the COVID list. Congressman Gallagher, you know, they'll be off the COVID list by Christmas Day. It's not going to save you.
Well, here we actually agree, Hugh, because the NFL's COVID protocols, as the great Aaron Rodgers very controversially illustrated in his own life, make absolutely no sense and are doing enormous damage to the product that we see on the field, as are the geriatric referees that we see every week wreaking havoc on the product on the field. I don't understand why we can't just fully automate the refereeing and install sensors throughout the stadium, on the ground, use people in the booth, and get rid of all this subjectivity that every single week seems to turn a few games here or there. So we actually are aligned on this, Hugh. I just have to say,
well, we are. Let's pause for a moment. The COVID protocols. Yesterday, the Browns put eight people on. Baker Mayfield's going to get myrtleized because two tackles are out. Wyatt Teller is out. Two of his tight ends out of three are out. And Kareem Hunt is injured. Now, that's not a COVID injury. That's an actual football injury. And Conklin's a football injury. But I don't think these guys are sick, Mike. I think it's the breakthrough variants, which are, don't make you sick. What is wrong? This is a, you know, I pay for these tickets. I buy these season tickets. This is not NFL football.
Well, just look at the, if you've been to a game this year, I've been to three Packers games this year. They're letting 85,000 fans go in the stadium with no masks next to each other, screaming, yelling, drinking massive quantities of beer. So clearly they're not worried about the health of the fans that they're profiting off of every single game. The contradiction is absurd. So it makes absolutely no sense. And Aaron Rodgers, when the controversy broke, put it out that he, because he was unvaccinated, and by the way, I'm vaccinated, so this isn't like an anti-vax thing before everyone freaks out. He has to sit there in his car every morning waiting for his test results to come back. Meanwhile, a vaccinated player takes the test and goes into the facility in the building and could still be positive while he's having breakfast and interacting with everybody. So there's all sorts of contradictions. It makes no sense, Hugh. But I just hope that we can enjoy Christmas Day by watching the Packers destroy the Browns.
Here's the springboard. You've springboarded. Yesterday, 99 Tories deserted Boris Johnson in Great Britain in an attempt to reimpose strict COVID protocols. I believe that free peoples are now at this position. I'd like to know your comment on this. We know what the deal is. We know that COVID can kill people who are old and infirm, people my age and older who have an underlying condition. We, you and I agree, get vaccinated, get the second shot. I've got a booster because I'm 65 and I think everyone ought to get a booster. But then I will make my own decision. I'm going to fly to Minnesota tonight in order to moderate a debate among GOP gubernatorial hopefuls. And a free people can make up their own doggone minds. And NFL players who are not playing in contract years. You know, Baker's out there playing with one leg and one hand because he's in a contract year. And if they put him on the bench, it's going to cost him millions of dollars and it's going to tick off fans everywhere. What is wrong with America that we've lost this idea that adults, once we are informed, I was all for all this stuff last year, 15 days to slow the spread. This is now nuts. We've officially passed into nuts land.
Well, at some point along the way, we seem to accept this idea that it is the role of the federal government to remove all risk from our lives. And that is simply not the case. That is not how a free people can possibly live. And at the end of the day, as you said, Hugh, everybody has to step up, take charge of their own health, and make decisions that are best for themselves or their family. And I get it. When this first happened, when this started 2 years ago, my wife was pregnant with our first child. You combine that with the fact that there was so little we knew about the virus back then. We were very risk averse on the front end. We were very risk averse. Now we're at a point, my wife and I are both vaccinated, where our strategy is basically vax and relax. And we want to live our lives. We feel like we can make intelligent decisions for ourselves, for our baby daughter, for our family. And it's not the role of the government to tell us whether we can celebrate Thanksgiving or Christmas with our loved ones, or whether we can go watch a Packers game on Christmas Day. By the way, the negotiations with my wife, Hugh, about being able to go watch the Browns on Christmas Day are not going very well. I regret to inform you. So,
we have a problem. We have a problem.
Family on December 25th.
In the Hewitt family, the tradition is gifts, movie, dinner. That's the tradition. That, unfortunately, will not work this year because the Browns will be beating the Packers at 4:30 Eastern. So now we have to do gifts, movie, Browns game, dinner. And that is not going over with the non-Browns fan, the fetching Mrs. Hewitt, who has raised up two Browns fans along with me. This is not flying. And so I don't know how you've negotiated the last years of marriage, because this is the first major split on a holiday we've had since we've been married 39 years ago.
Well, we only have 2 years compared to your 39. So this is probably the first major split we're confronting. So we're working through it. Luckily, I've adopted the position that my wife is always right. And that seems to be a wise strategy.
Mike Gallagher, I was going to give you the real answer, which is she's right. If you want to get to 39, whatever you say, dear, after you've made your best case two or three times.
This is the advice I'm getting from my friends who've been married for a long time. Hugh, if I could go back to your point about healthcare very quickly, I think the same thing applies more broadly to our entire healthcare system. We have a system that's evolved to a point where it largely treats illness as opposed to keeping people healthy. And so much of what we need to do is get upstream of that healthcare problem and incentivize people to take charge of their own health. And to do preventive medicine and have a system that rewards hospitals and physicians for keeping people out of the healthcare system as opposed to just the expensive illness treatment system we have right now. But the fact is, America is not headed in that direction. The numbers of obesity are on the rise. And if anything, the last 2 years should have been a time to step back and reflect on all the things we can do to live healthier lives, but we don't.
Mike, can I talk to you about this? I'm a perfect example. I was fit for 30 years, then I was fat for 30 years, and now I'm fit again. Because what else is there to do during a COVID except walk and trundle along? So I've lost 40 pounds. So the question becomes, what happens at 30? Kids happen at 30. You stop running. Maybe you'll find this out soon. There's no more time to do what you've been doing to stay in good shape. And I know you were previously the fastest man in Congress, and you're slowing down with age. And I think Cotton won this year, right? But in any event, no. Okay, two in a row? Is that two in a row?
That's four in a row, Hugh. So
four in a row? You should let civilians run in that. You should let commentators run, and then you'd be dust. What's your best marathon time?
It's very slow, Hugh.
Okay, 3:12. Just putting that out. Call me when you're at 3:12, and then we'll talk. In any event, when I was your age. But now you're going to get fat because you got to chase that toddler. How do you change that dynamic?
Well, I think one thing we can do is look at all the ways in which the federal government is subsidizing things that are bad for us, whether it's sugar or other things. I think there's some interesting things that have been done with Medicare Advantage, with the Silver Shoes program for older Americans and incentivizing them to get into the gym and get active. But I think it's mostly a cultural thing. It's why I'm actually very excited about the way in which the media landscape is changing, and you're seeing younger men in particular gravitating towards things like Joe Rogan's podcast, Jocko Willing's podcast, a lot of things that talk about fitness, jiu-jitsu, getting out there, getting active, lifting weights. It's absolutely essential, particularly as we're spending more of our day glued to our screen. It's more important than ever for kids to get out there and get active and develop that healthy lifestyle. But
yeah, 5K is not really exercise. I want to point that out. Congressman, I got to talk to you about Build Back Better before we run out of time. Actually, I'm going to talk to you about the Chinese. Do you know who Wang Huning is, the chief theorist of the Chinese Communist Party?
I read that long-form piece last month about the impact of his academic work on Xi Jinping, so I'm loosely familiar with it.
Okay, so the Palladium piece, I'm calling attention to it in a column which will be in the Post today. It seems to me that the search for core values explains a lot that he is after, explains a lot of what Xi is up to. How do we influence them to understand it can't be Leninist Marxist theory? That will collapse.
You're talking about how do we convince the members of the Chinese Communist Party or the Chinese people here?
The Chinese Communist Party.
Well, if it's the former, I think it's going to be very difficult to convince Xi and his small cadre of true believers, because I think we underestimate the extent to which they are committed Leninists. This is a point that Matt Pottinger, David Feith, and others have made repeatedly. And ultimately, they believe, having studied extensively the ways in which the Soviet Union went wrong and failed, they believe they've learned from those mistakes and perfected that Leninist model, and now are using technology to perfect totalitarianism. And so ultimately, I think our long-term strategy needs to involve, on some level, driving a wedge between the party, and granted, the party has 80 million members, it has more members than Germany has citizens, but the core party and the Chinese people. Because the Chinese people, in many ways, I believe over the long term, are our allies. The Chinese people are the biggest victims of the repression of the party. And ultimately, I do think this model, if we hold firm, if we stay strong, if we merely defend the borders of the free world right now, and foremost among those are the borders of Taiwan. Ours is a defensive strategy. We're not trying to take territory or upend the status quo. We're trying to defend it. If we do that, I believe over the long term, their model will collapse. But it does count on us returning, and I say returning because I think we've abandoned it, to the model of freedom and responsibility, individual responsibility and subsidiarity here in America. We're actually moving in some ways towards a CCP light model where we want the federal government to do everything for us, to end where we began, Hugh. If we go further down that path, we will actually defeat ourselves. We will become the very thing we are trying to defeat. And that's really what concerns me over the long term.
Well put. We'll come back to this because I do believe there's an opportunity to persuade Wang, Mr. Wang, that their road will not work. Last quick question. Have you heard from Ron Johnson yet whether he's running in 2022?
I have not. I suspect he will run, and I will be fully supportive of him running. And he's.
I know that.
The Democrats are going to nominate a crazy progressive that is out of step with the common sense values that Wisconsinites hold dear. I can guarantee you that, Hugh.
I know that, but I'm hoping that the senator is just freezing the field, so you can go there, go to the Senate, we can find a new member of the David Dreyer chair, which has been held by Tom Cotton, John Campbell, Mike Pompeo, now Mike Gallagher. The previous men held some rational views on football. Congressman Gallagher doesn't. Good to see you, Congressman. Talk to you next week.
Thank you.
The relieffactor.com. Love talking to Mike. You know, There are some smart people in Congress. Two of them, Michael Waltz and Michael Gallagher, and the NixonSeminar.com. That's the best seminar you can sign up for this year. It meets nine times a year. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com. Gallagher is the only guy who's read the Palladium article about Wang Huning. ReliefFactor.com. Take that, feel better. You'll be able to stay pace with Gallagher. He's not very fast. Congress is slow. They got guys out there with walkers and gals out there in chairs, and they're trying to, you know, and Gallagher thinks it's a medal worth displaying. 312, Mike, 312. Put that on the wall, and I'll talk to you. ReliefFactor.com. Icarian Curcumin, Resveratrol, and Omega. Icarian Curcumin, Resveratrol, and Omega. That what makes the minor aches and pains that come with the exercise and whatever silver shoes is, that's what you need. ReliefFactor.com. That producer price index number is very alarming. Brian Wesbury is next to talk to us about it here on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Key City Capital.
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
The Democrats know they're going to lose power in 2022, but that doesn't mean they want to remake the entire landscape of American politics. For whatever reason, Hillary Clinton is still doing press. And she's now saying the exact same thing that the left has been repeating, that Biden has been repeating. Instead of governing the country, taking responsibility for your actions, you see, you could tell a leader from a follower, you could tell someone who actually has done something in their life by whether or not they take responsibility when something does not go right. Biden does not do this. Hillary does not do this. Obama never did this. Churchill did this.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
We all know everything is more intense when the climate is warming. Everything. And obviously it has some impact here, but I can't give you a quantitative read on that.
At least not yet, but he'll call the EPA and they'll tell him. Yes, Mr. President, climate change spawned the tornadic activity we saw over the weekend. Yeah, and it was because it was 0.1% higher, the core, the climate. And you know why? Because we drive too many cars. It's our fault. And you know what country is to blame for it all? It's America. It's not China. It's nobody. It's us. We're always the bad guys.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I'm here to tell you that the Democrats are in big, big trouble. Joe Biden's not going to run for re-election. You know that. I know that. Every time I play a clip of the president, he is infirm. He can't do the job. And God bless him and keep him and get him through the next 3.5 years. Here's the problem. I saw John Ellis, one of the smartest people in politics, circulate his newsletter yesterday in which he said, look at the Democratic bench. It's a nightmare. Hillary is in the ready room. She's in the green room. And it begins to make sense. Dwayne's been putting Hillary in my clips, and I won't play Hillary because Hillary's old news. Well, maybe not. So what do you think about a 2024 race that's a replay of 2016? That'll be good for the country, won't it? It's not going to be Kamala Harris. Kamala Harris was at a White House, event yesterday on Build Back Better for him. First of all, she stole credit for the Paycheck Protection Program that was Trump, Rubio, and Susan Collins doing, cut number 12.
If you connect a thriving economy with a thriving community and understand that our small business leaders are also civic leaders, they are also community leaders, and what we did with the PPP program, and also what we did to recognize how previous outreach to, in particular, minority and women-owned businesses have not worked.
First of all, the we is named Mitch McConnell, Susan Collins, and Marco Rubio, and Donald Trump signed it. That's who did PPP. Mitch said, Susan and Marco, you do this. They came up with PPP. That's what saved the economy. That's what allowed small businesses to stay alive. So, Vice President Harris, that's not going to fly. Then she goes on to ring the bell that she's rung for many years. Cut number 13.
An economy in which black people supported one another, lift one another up, and modeled excellence. In which black people could determine their own future. Some of us refer to that as self-determination. To put equity firmly at the center of our economic policy. So I talk about that today because I believe we must draw from the lessons of Greenwood and Friedman's, of Sweet Auburn and Blaylock Van. We must be intentional. Here's what I know to be true.
Let me interpret this for you in case you have no idea. When the word equity arises, that means redistribution. That means that making the taller shorter because you can't make the shorter taller. And equity is simply transfers of wealth. And she is referring to historically successful black business areas that were historically successful and that for various, many times, malign reasons no longer exist. Equity, however, would mean central planning and the redistribution of wealth on the basis of race, which is unconstitutional. So Kamala Harris is making a naked appeal to the hardest core partisan for equity politics, and it will not fly in America. It won't. So she ends with a whopper at this forum. Cut number 14.
Our economy is growing faster than it has in decades. Unemployment is down. Stop.
You know that's not true. I know that that's not true. We know that they shut down the economy. They, being the federal government under Donald Trump, has been shut down. It was reopened under Trump and Biden, so this year's growth numbers are great, and they're artificial because we shut down the economy. We know that inflation is killing that growth for many tens of millions of Americans. We know all of this. And so what does Kamala Harris later in the day talk about? Electric cars. Cut 17.
It's plugged in, so is it plugged into just the normal electric socket, right?
Yes. Normally it's a 240 volt, but you can go ahead and plug in and that's it.
Okay.
Yeah.
There we are.
That's it.
And there's no sound or fume.
There is nothing.
Yes.
And that's
so
all there is.
For all
to
of
it.
Us who are used to
every morning
to filling our tank, we you usually can smell it and you can hear it. You can hear the guzzling sound.
Right.
None of that.
So
how do I know it's actually working?
It is.
You know, Madam Vice President, because you're never going to drive yourself again. And that's okay. That's what we do. I hope they still have protection on Mike Pence. I hope they still have protection the number of crazies in our country are growing. The Iranians are trying to kill people. They need a protection around a lot more people, and it's a minuscule amount of money. But you're never going to drive yourself again. And Doug filled up the car anyway, the second gentleman. Here's what I am to tell you. The worst retail politician I have ever seen. And years ago, I was in Central Park with Van Jones at the request of Katie Couric, who's coming up next hour. And I told the audience that Kamala Harris was going to be the nominee, and they all shouted. But that was based on California politics, which are false positives. California is not America. It's crazy. And so I was wrong. She's a terrible retail politician. You can't put in what God left out, to quote Chariots of Fire. I do think John Ellis is right. They have a terrible bench. Gina Raimondo, Cooper, yeah, there's Jared Polis in Colorado. But what I'm really thinking about now is Hillary is, in fact, getting ready to run. Because if you can be Joe Biden and be president, why not be as old as Hillary? Why not be Donald Trump age? I'll be right back, America. Katie Couric ahead. Well, I'm not. Yeah, but I'm not gonna play.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Do the police have a disproportionate interaction with certain areas of city that are predominantly black and brown? Yes, and that's because of the crime. You know, you go where the fish are. Don't you want the police to be where the crime is highest? And I think Democrats do it because they know that if they can get 13% or so of the black vote, 13% or so of the vote, which is black vote, angry, and convince them that we are the party of social justice and those guys over there, Republicans, are the party of racism, They can get that large percentage of the black vote without which they cannot win. And I think one of the reasons they're doubling down on this kind of nonsense is because more and more black voters are rethinking their emotional, in my opinion, allegiance to the Democratic Party. Donald Trump got 12% of the black vote in 2020. He got 8% in 2016. That's a 50% increase. And he got 20% of the black male vote, largely because of his economy, best economy for blacks in history. Prison reform, doing something about the borders. And the reason that's relevant is because most of the illegal aliens who come here are unskilled, and they compete for jobs that otherwise would be held by people living in the inner city with high school or less education, and they put downward pressure on their wages. He also pardoned Jack Johnson, the first black heavyweight champion, pardoned Alice Johnson, the woman that had a very long sentence for a nonviolent drug offense. He did the Music Modernization Act. And some 5,000 or so blacks, mostly black men, were able to take part of his prison reform and have their sentences reconsidered and reduced an average of 70 months. So for all those reasons, Donald Trump increased substantially his percentage of the black vote. And so they're now doubling down on calling Republicans racist and calling the police racist.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Last night I traveled. My wife and I went to a rare, what they call dinner party. I don't tend to go to them, but this was special people. Anyway, we saw very, very few homes with lighting. And I said to her, I wish we had a picture of these blocks that we're driving through from 40 years ago. I'll bet half the homes had lights up or some other decoration. Do you know, among its other terrible, horrible, destructive consequences, secular society makes it less happy. Makes it more boring, which is why so many people gravitate to excitement. Secularism is, as a general rule, a boring place to live. So people are bored, and they look for excitement. Religious people have excitement being religious. Yes, it's exciting to be religious. Did you know that? I know that because I am. The amount of joy and excitement that my religious life brings to me is immeasurable, especially leading everything as my weekly Sabbath.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
Seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
The Democrats are not interested in running the government. They're interested in running politics. They want to turn America into California, a permanent one-party state. Play cut nine.
People who I knew that I served with, who fall in line on the outrageous accusations they make, whether it's against Dr. Tony Fauci or pretending that what happened on January 6th wasn't an insurrection, honestly, they have hung their spines up on the wall as they walk into their offices. They have no conscience, they have no spine. And we are seeing the results of a party that has been taken over by a demagogue.
Taken over by a demagogue. Hillary Clinton predicts, though, that Trump is running in 2024, saying that Trump is going to run again. You see, the Democrat Party's on life support. Their voters know that the country's falling apart, double-digit inflation, borders are wide open. Our military has been completely gutted and depleted. Morale is at an all-time low. China is doing whatever they want, and whatever reason they're trying to reorganize us by beating the drums of war, saying, let's go defend Ukraine's borders while we can't defend our own borders. The American manufacturing base continues to be eroded, but the one thing that can reanimate the Democrat base, what could get her motivated? Donald Trump.
If I were a betting person right now, I'd say Trump is going to run again. But I want people to understand that this is a make or break point. Are we going to give in to all of these lies?
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Relit their second tree yesterday. Cut three is going to show you the ceremony yesterday as once again, that beautiful 50-foot high tree with over 10,000 glass ornaments, 100,000 lights, we're not going to let him ruin Christmas. Fox News debuted their new all-American Christmas tree yesterday. This on-air lighting took place during the five yesterday. Both Fox News Media and Fox Corporation each made a $100,000 donation to answer the call, which provides financial assistance to the families of fallen service members of the Fire Department of New York and the NYPD, two agencies, again, who responded very bravely the other night to take care of this.
Keep up.
Morning Glory America, bonjour, hi, Kennedy, Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway. I am planning to go to Minnesota after this show, but a listener just tweeted at me. High wind warning for Minnesota tonight. Potentially historic high wind event tonight. A very powerful low pressure system will track through later today and this evening. Damaging winds with gusts of up to 60 to 65 miles an hour are likely across all of the upper Midwest and upper Mississippi River Valley tonight. An additional line of severe thunderstorms will develop along fast-moving cold front early this evening. This line of thunderstorms could contain gusts in excess of 80 miles per hour, some embedded tornadoes. That would be bad to have an embedded tomato. I've got one of those producing the show. Dense fog advisory in effect until noon today. I don't have to worry about that. High wind warning effect from 9 p.m. this evening to 6 a.m. Jim Geraghty, should I go to Minnesota tonight?
Shouldn't the entire forecast you just laid out, Hugh, just be described as winter in Minnesota?
Well, that's what I think. I mean, don't they have salt trucks? Are there no orphans? You know, what, that orphanages? Are there no workhouses? That's Minnesota, right?
Yeah, well, okay, hang on. Maybe it's a supply chain issue, or because of inflation, they're out there instead of with the usual big trucks. They're just out there with little salt shakers. Doing it, you know, shaking with their hands bit by bit on the road as they go.
Well, like the mail, debates must go forward. Jim Geraghty, what would you add? There are five candidates coming, two current state senators, one former state senator, one rich doctor, and one mayor of a city, and they all want to run against Tim Walz. What would you ask them?
There are probably a lot of easy, you know, layup questions on, you know, what happened in Minneapolis and abolishing the police and all that kind of stuff. I think one of the good ways of looking at governing is that anybody who's in the executive branch, whether it's a president or a governor, it's almost like you're a genie with one wish. You have one policy thing that you can get done. Everything else you can try, and if you're lucky, you get a couple of things done. But generally, you begin your term with enough political capital, with one top priority, and then over time, events pop up, natural disasters and scandals and resignations and you know, just the course of events takes over and starts setting the agenda for you. So, if you have one ability to get one piece of legislation through the legislature, what is that piece of legislation?
Okay, I have to work on it because Hugh's rules are in effect. I only do debates when Hugh's rules are in effect, which there are three. No questions longer than 30 seconds because it's not about the panel. No answer longer than 75 seconds or the bell begins to bing, bing, bing. And no right of reply because I watch Donald Trump, you know, use that like a machine. It was a virtuoso performer of the right of reply. So I've got to get that done, but that's a good thing. If you could get one thing done in the chaos of 4 years, what would it be? That's a good question. Now, Jim, I want you to go over what you covered at length yesterday, which is the texts, because the texts are not a scandal. I looked at those texts. I said, what did they want them to text? I didn't text Mark Meadows on January 6th, but I would have texted. What I put on Twitter was, this is outrageous. Stop it, Mr. President. Isn't that what they texted him?
Well, you might be thinking of one of my colleagues. I did not write about the text yesterday.
What'd you write about yesterday?
I wrote, well, today's Morning Jolt is all about Dr. Sanjay Gupta's book, World War C, in which he discussed.
No, you did a long text string yesterday about something that I thought was typically indispensable, Jim Geraghty.
You know, might have been one of my evil twins. Nonetheless, here's the thing. So I think my colleague, Michael Brennan Doherty, has a good piece in which he basically points out you were getting messages from Laura Ingraham and Sean Hannity saying, we need an address to the country. You need to put out a statement on this. You need, you know. And Michael Brennan Doherty says, this is a man who takes television very, very seriously, much more seriously than he takes his constitutional duties. I think in the entirety of the impeachment, this is what I wanted to know most, and that, in fact, didn't get answered, and that, in fact, the hearings of impeachment, it kind of dropped. You know, they just wanted to get this done as quickly as possible. I want to know what Donald Trump was saying and doing as things on January 6th got worse. And they were turned into, you know, from a protest to a conflict to a riot to the point where some numbskulls were smearing human feces on the walls of the U.S. Capitol building. That's what I'm curious. I want to know what Trump was saying and doing. Because there were reports. Ben Sasse, I believe, was on your program, who said he'd heard from people in the White House saying Trump was elated about this, that he was cheering about this.
There is no evidence of that yet. I did ask the president on this show, did he intend for them to storm the Capitol? He said no. And I haven't seen anyone else ask him that.
Do you think Donald Trump, with his legendary reputation for honesty, was going to say, yes, yes, I did?
No, I just know that you have to ask and answer. Here's the difference between me and a lot of people on January 6th. When Nancy Pelosi neutered the committee, she killed the interest of America in it. Because unless you have a protagonist and antagonist, no one will watch. And Jim Banks, with a good counsel, and Jim Jordan at his right-hand side, that would have been must-see TV. Nobody cares, Jim, because it's a show trial.
I suppose. What they're going to find is what they're going to find. I think Republicans probably ended up cutting off their nose to spite their face by not participating in this, which means they don't have anybody on that, you know, panel to say.
I'm not going to blame them. I am going to blame Nancy Pelosi, who tried to derail a long-standing tradition, which is when we have a select committee, you pick your leaders, you pick your councils, I don't put the other team's players on the field.
I'm no fan of Nancy Pelosi, but I have a really hard time seeing that when the grand history of January 6th is written, Nancy Pelosi will be seen as the villain.
Oh, no, I'm not saying that, Jim. Come on, I'm not saying. I'm saying that the January 6th committee is a failure and has no interest outside of the Beltway because they neutered it. They took it away from the standard operating, which has produced great committees, whether it's Benghazi or Iran-Contra, dating back 30 years. If you don't have antagonist and protagonist, it doesn't work as a matter of drama.
I do think the January 6th committee will come out with its reports, and unless it has something new that we have not heard yet, then it's probably going to come and go, much like the torture report that was issued during the late Obama years.
Yeah, dialectic is necessary to drama on the Hill. I know what you were typing about yesterday. I want to go back to it. James Bond. And I was applauding every tweet. Would you state your case for Bond as Bond?
Sure. This comes from a stray comment by Barbara Broccoli, who now controls the Bond franchise. She was doing an interview on a podcast, and it's entirely possible that this answer should not be taken to mean much of anything. They asked if the next actor who could playing James Bond. She said James Bond will remain a man, that they will not change to Jane Bond or something like that. But then, they asked, could the next James Bond be non-binary? And the person said, Barbara Rockley said, yes, it could be. Anything's possible. And, there's some people who said, look, this is just kind of the, sure, whatever type answer. Or maybe this is genuinely a direction they want to go in. And I've been listening. One of the people I've been enjoying on YouTube is this extremely profane. So your listeners, if they go looking for him, you've been warned. Scottish movie critic named The Critical Drinker, who kind of does this persona of this wild, crazy, hard-drinking maniac. But he's actually a really good, does great analysis of character and plot and all that stuff. And he's right of center, or at least he's very frustrated with, wokeism and the message as he characterized it in Hollywood. But what he really got into, and you see this, big franchise after big franchise, Star Wars, Star Trek, The Terminator, how well-established characters, generally who are played by actors who are now getting up there in their 50s, 60s, and 70s. Mark Hamill, Linda Hamilton, Harrison Ford, they're playing characters who are now well past their prime. But when these characters come back, these beloved characters that we grew up with and we, pretended to be in our backyards and dressed up for Halloween and all that kind of stuff, that generally they come back as sad and bitter and that they've actually been defeated. And when we last saw them, they were at their great triumph. The movie credits roll. They come back 2 decades later, and the answer is actually no. Luke Skywalker is now a bitter old man. You could not save the galaxy. He's now drinking green milk from some space alien breast. It's really horrible. Jean-Luc Picard is sitting on his vineyard in France as a bitter old man, seen as past his prime. And it's kind of this sad, messaging, which is basically that it's not just like characters are aging. I think Logan, the last Wolverine movie, did this great, kind of serious tackling of aging and the inevitability of mortality, all kinds of stuff like that. This is very much, we're tearing down these old characters to build up these new characters. And oh, by the way, these old characters, they were patriarchal, they were heteronormative, they were neocolonial, all this kind of stuff. And it's this really frustrating, repeated action over and over again
You know what you've done? I've got to go watch The Man Who Would Be King on the plane today. So I can get Michael Caine and Sean Connery in their prime, marching over the bridge when they've been to... Well, I won't give the spoiler. Have you watched it, Jim?
I might have been on basic cable years ago, so...
The Man Who Would Be King. That's whatever you just said, heteronormative, patriarchal, and grand. Thank you, my friend. Geraghty the Indispensable. You can find him at NRO. You ought to get the Morning Jolt. You can sign up for it at National Review. And I'll be right back, America. Stay tuned.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Relit their second tree yesterday. Cut 3 is going to show you the ceremony yesterday as once again that beautiful 50-foot high tree with over 10,000 glass ornaments, 100,000 lights was relighted yesterday on 6th Avenue. Cut 3.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Light. Oh! Yay!
It's pretty good.
It's beautiful.
It's very nice.
It's stunning.
And yes, it is beautiful and stunning. And you notice that a lot of police officers and firefighters were involved in that ceremony as they were invited by Fox News because they responded the other night when this thug was spotted burning the tree. This guy had been arrested 2 times for drug possession, once for public intoxication, and he's back out on the street. But they were not going to let him ruin Christmas. Fox News debuted their new All-American Christmas tree yesterday. This on-air lighting took place during the 5 yesterday. Both Fox News Media and Fox Corporation each made a $100,000 donation to Answer the Call, which provides financial assistance to the families of fallen service members of the Fire Department of New York and the NYPD, two agencies, again, who responded very bravely the other night to take care of this.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I'll have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I'm going to get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd. A bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
How 1 million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Liebau for townhall.com. China has built the largest DNA database in the world, and it's only growing. This should concern all of us. That's because China could use this information in the future, perhaps, for example, to build bioweapons targeting specific ethnic groups. Given this background, common sense dictates that Americans shouldn't be storing their DNA or other personal information with Chinese-linked firms. Quite sensibly, after getting an FBI briefing about the firm's connections to China, the Los Angeles County Sheriff notified the county that his office wouldn't work with Fulgent. That's the genetics firm LA County hired for mandatory COVID testing and registration. Fulgent even admits in a public disclaimer it stores information outside the United States, where data privacy protections may not be as secure. I'll bet. What's alarming is how many others have chosen to work with Fulgent. The question is why.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.
I think all the Christmas trees are going to get blown over in Minnesota tonight. I'm heading to Minneapolis-St. Paul after the show today to moderate a debate tonight among the five would-be Republican nominees for governor to run against Tim Walz. I'm always happy to have duffel bag will travel, but the wind advisory for 80-mile-per-hour winds and tornadoes, the fetching Mr. Hewitt asked, where are you staying? And I said, hopefully a hotel with a basement. That's what I want. The devastation in Kentucky and Missouri and Illinois continues to be, Tennessee continues to be heartbreaking. People are helping. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. I have to tell you, never send me anything you don't want played 100 times on the radio. My friend Carl sent me a wonderful, cute video of his grandson, George, saying this.
Pipe down, Poppy.
Pipe down, Poppy. It's now a hashtag, PDP. And I just tweeted out whenever he comes after me about being old or a Browns fan. I just put out hashtag PDP because I want him to remember.
Pipe down, Poppy.
Pipe down, Poppy. And I think George is ahead of the game. And I told him it's going to live on forever. For example, like the time that I said, hey, Dwayne, can you pull up your screen? Watch this video. And Adam, can you play for us Dwayne in the spider video?
Ah! Jeez.
You know what? I don't even know how to spell that. Would you play that again, Adam?
Ah!
Okay, that was Dwayne and me laughing. How do you spell that, Dwayne?
This coming from a person who famously misspelled Ohio.
Right, but how do you? Let's play it again so you can hear it, Adam.
Ah!
That's what you said. That's you. I know how to spell pipe down Poppy, PDP, but how do you spell? It again so people can hear.
I think you start with an F and you go from there.
No, you don't.
Oh.
Yo, go away. Turn off his camera. I'm going to talk about Angel Tree now. First, listen to a volunteer who wants to be anonymous about their work with Angel Tree.
These kids, they're special, and they didn't ask for this to happen to them. We've become quite a little family. We really have. And she looked at that tag and she said, my daddy gave me a gift, and he loves me. It just means everything. It's Christmas.
Volunteers just give money, the vast majority, because they're not connected up with an Angel Tree. They can't do the delivery. But we had an Angel Tree volunteer call in unprompted today to say they've been taking their kids for years when they were smaller to do the Angel Tree deliveries. Because they do. It's presents, a Bible, and a note from mom or dad who's incarcerated. That takes $25 from you. And if you go to HughHewitt.com, you go to the top of the webpage, you will see there that you can give $25, $50, $125, $250, $500, $1,000, $25,000. You can give whatever you want. And every $25 makes another Angel Tree delivery possible. So thank you for your generosity. Thanks to the volunteers who make it happen. Thanks to Prison Fellowship that have run Angel Tree all these years. Thanks to Jim Ackerman, who's got it ready to go with every conceivable backup plan for an Omicron Christmas. Thank you, all of you. Let me check the market for our AndrewandTodd.com time. Yesterday, the Dow was down 106, the NASDAQ down 175, the S&P was off 34. And that is going to happen again today, I think. Now, I'm not a prophet nor a son of a prophet. I don't do market reports. I don't do pre-market reports. I tell you what's going on in Europe, where it's red in England and it's green in France and Germany, because they're close to the end of their market day. And usually by end of market day, you get a sense of where, although things turn around in the last 5 minutes. I've never understood market reports. But I know what the 10-year Treasury is. It's at 1.438, up from 1.424 yesterday. And after the Fed's open Markets Committee meeting today. They're going to come out and give some guidance, maybe tomorrow. And Kurt Schlichter can give you the bad news. Interest rates are going up because the producer price index went up 9.6%. That means you're screwed if you're not already in the process of getting a loan or in the hunt for a house. Get going. Go to andrewandtodd.com. They're a Sierra Pacific Mortgage. They're a great sponsor of this show. Or call them at 888-888-1172. Don't wait. These interest rates are leaving. They're going to leave town. 888-888-1172. Get on the train when you can. Katie Couric is next on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
And the Democrats' approach to everything is the sort of low-calorie fudge. You know what I mean? It's like, it's police presence, it's discipline, it's all the things we know. It's diet and exercise. And their thing is, but what if we reimagined diet and exercise? Well, there's 200,000 books on Amazon trying to reimagine diet and exercise. It doesn't work. It's gravity. It's all there is. You cannot reimagine policing. You cannot pull back policing. You can't reimagine this stuff. It just is. And we won't face that. Half of society is not facing reality in many realms. Financially, you know, from a police standpoint, diet and exercise. It's just diet and exercise.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
But he knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified. I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified. You can't see it.
Collusion. You just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
I did Bob Dole's eulogy today. He asked me on his deathbed whether I would do his eulogy. We're friends. We disagreed, but we're friends. We used to have an awful lot of that relationship, and there still exists, except that the QAnon and the extreme elements of the Republican Party and what Donald Trump keeps sort of, seems to me, feeding the, you know, with the big lie, it makes it awful hard. There's a, and I think most Republicans, and there's an awful lot of Republicans in Congress, I think, would agree.
It's a very important quote, because basically what Biden is saying is, why is it that I can't get along with establishment Republicans like I did when Bob Dole was in office? And the reason's very clear. It's because Republicans hoodwinked their voters and were perfectly fine doing deals with charlatans like you, Joe Biden. So Republican parties have, the Republican Party, at least the base of the party, we're awake now. It has nothing to do with QAnon, whatever that is, or the big lie. No, it has to do with, you know what? We're not okay with the adventurous, endless wars in countries we can't pinpoint on a map. We're not okay with keeping our borders wide open and acting as if that is an act of diversity. And basically, there's Joe Biden kind of engaging in some nostalgia, saying, I miss when we used to be able to vote to...
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt, the interview today with Katie Couric of fame on the Today Show and CBS and every other place in America. Her brand new book, Going There, is a bestseller. It's a mortal lock for husbands and fathers looking for the perfect Christmas present. Good morning, Katie. Thank you for joining me.
Hi, Hugh. So nice to be with you.
Congratulations. This is a magnificent book. I'm going to recommend to people they get the Audible version, because I've never actually heard as well produced an Audible book as this. If I can, I'm going to play a little excerpt. I don't think I violate the copyright here, because it tells people why they want to listen. Here we go.
The raspy voice Bobby, who'd seen it all, did my makeup. A hairstylist named Catherine blew out my short do. A wardrobe woman, stout and stern, steamed my dress. I reviewed my notes, walked into the studio, and sat in my chair. The audio engineer clipped on my mic. Bryant looked over and said, "You good?" I said yes, even though I wasn't so sure. Jimmy Straka, the stage manager, boomed, "30 seconds to air!" At the stroke of 7, against the theme music, staccato trumpets and swelling strings, the announcer intoned for the first time ever.
From NBC News, this is Today with Bryant Gumbel, Catherine Couric, and Joe Garagiola.
If there was any confusion among the audience about why I was sitting there, Bryant dispelled it, with perhaps a little less tact than the moment required.
In case you haven't gotten the message, Katie is now a permanent fixture up here, a member of our family, and especially welcome one. Deborah Norville is not.
Yikes. As for that Catherine in the intro, I still used it to counteract my Campbell Soup Kid looks. In real life, though, nobody called me Catherine.
All right, that's enough. Katie Couric, that's why this Audible book is so great, is because of the inlays and the inflection. How long did it take you to lay this down?
Well, we had an incredibly talented producer put it together, but it took me 8 days to read it. And then Adriana Fazio, who was my trusty researcher and partner in crime along with Lucy Kalin for the book, had pulled a lot of these things so I could rewatch them and look at them and think about them. And so we had them on hand, and it, you know, we wanted it to be feel like more like a narrative podcast with sound bites and clips from interviews, and we put the letter that Sullivan Ballou had written to his wife, Sarah, from Ken Burns' Civil War series, because that was read at my husband Jay's funeral. So, you know, I'm glad you appreciated it, Hugh, because a lot of work went into putting it together. And I think it really brings back people to, you know, let them see and hear what some of these moments were like and not just read them.
Well, the David Duke interview excerpt, which I'll come back to, is another, I mean, that to include the actual audio is a unique experience. And I'm an Audible book consumer, but the fetching Mrs. Hugh, as I refer to my wife, she blew through this. She inhaled it. I have three sets of questions in for you. I have my wife's, my daughter-in-law, my pregnant daughter with three other kids, does not have the time yet, but she will do it soon. Let me start with my wife's most interesting comment. Katie had a loving, stable, and strong family life as a child, planting seeds for a successful career. And she got that because you were kind of on the cusp of middle class, upper middle class. No sure thing, vacations, winter coats every year, movies, but no candies. It's a perfect sort of middle, upper middle class upbringing. But Ellie and Carrie get a different life. They get a life of their mom being a superstar. Do you wish they had your life? Are you confident that they had the better choice?
Oh, listen, I think I had a wonderful upbringing. I think to your wife, Bessie's point, Hugh, I mean, I had wonderful parents. I'm not sure, you know, what qualifies as upper middle class, but I think we were pretty decidedly middle class. And I also think some of the way we were raised was informed by the fact that my parents were children of the Depression and very, very frugal, just disdained any kind of ostentatious behavior. And really, I don't know, my mother was more privileged than I growing up. Her dad was an architect and developer in Omaha. And I think in a way she was, even though she loved my dad so much, was slightly disappointed that we didn't live higher on the hog, as she might say. But Ellie and Carrie, you know, I have to say, I think many of my parents' values were so infused in me, and I handed them down to Ellie and Carrie to value things, to appreciate things. Obviously, they had a much, much more privileged life than I did. They went to private school, and I never had to worry about money, which is a huge relief. And I know an incredibly, I'm incredibly grateful for that. But I think I think that I taught them how to value things. I tell a story about how my daughter Ellie wanted this thing called a Baby G watch in like fourth grade, which was $100. And I said, absolutely not.
No way.
My younger daughter called me from La Perla, which is, you know, super fancy high end lingerie store because her friend and her friend's mother were buying new bras. I was like, are you out of your mind? So I think I even said, I don't even get my under things at La Perla. So I think I tried to really focus on what should be valued. We always did they'd have lemonade stands to raise money for cancer research or women in Afghanistan. So I think they're great girls. So I hopefully did something right. But it was challenging, as I wrote in the book, to be in this kind of, you know, world of quote unquote celebrity, which I never consider myself a celebrity. I kind of bristle at that word, but affluence, that I had growing, you know, raising them in New York City.
Now I've got to ask, because again, this is the second of the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt's question, not one that she articulated, but the story that she told most often to guests in our homes in the months since we've listened to your book is about Doris the nanny. And it's a cautionary tale. Did you expect that to resonate? You know, when people read books, they tell the same stories about the books over and over again. And I think the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt will be telling Doris the Nanny stories for a long time.
Well, you know, I did want it to be a cautionary tale, Hugh. I think, you know, that relationship that a mother in particular has with her child's caregiver, especially if they live in the home, can be very fraught. Boundaries can be broken. And I've always had sort of trouble with boundaries, honestly. I think she probably knew that in terms of, you know, I get very close to people. I try to be welcoming and inclusive. And yes, Doris the nanny was, it was actually also an important message from me to listen to your gut. You know, if something doesn't feel right, if something feels uncomfortable and weird, like Doris asking me to hug her before she went to bed, as a woman almost 50 years old, and me thinking, oh, she has no one in her life, no one loves her, I feel so bad for her, and me acquiescing to her request, it's like, no, that is really weird. If something like that is happening, don't make excuses for it. Don't compromise your own kind of gut, and know that that just isn't appropriate. And of course, she's got real serious.
Yeah, you're sympathetic. You're sympathetic. But I just want people to understand there are amazing life lessons in going there. It's not a story of I knew this person and I did this interview. It's actually about, in fact, I want to go to where my daughter-in-law's first question. It's about getting there, not going there, but getting there. She asked, how are you so confident at such a young age? Don't know many young people who bluff their way past the front desk with a fake appointment. I mean, do you recommend that to young women now?
Well, it wasn't really a fake appointment. I'd like to correct that. Basically, I used my connections. When I went to ABC News in Washington, I had applied for a job there as a desk assistant, the lowest rung on the ladder. I basically said to the receptionist, hi, is Davey Newman there? And she said no. And I said, he was the executive producer of World News Tonight. And I said, I'd love to say hi. And she said, well, we don't let people up who don't have appointments. And I said, well, can I call him? And then I called him and I said, hi, Davey, you don't know me, but my sister Kiki went to Yorktown High School with your twin brother, Steve and Eddie. And I also know your niece, Julie Newman. We used to play together because she lives right up the street from me. Can I come and say hello? So I didn't really fake an appointment. I used my quote-unquote dubious connection to Davey to just kind of go up and say hi to see if I could win him over or to see if I could get my foot in the door. And so I don't know if I was – I guess I want that did take a certain level of confidence.
Oh, my
I also,
gosh. Yes. Oh, my. Now, I want to make sure I mention to people before I go to our very fun question. You were a Pentagon reporter. I went to the memorial service for Post employees yesterday of Fred Hyatt. I don't know if you ever crossed paths with Fred at the Pentagon. Pentagon reporters are serious people. I mean, that is the best place to begin a reporting career, don't you think?
Oh, yeah. Well, I think it gives you automatic street cred. If you have to learn about missile systems and, you know, war strategy, and you have to kind of endure those Pentagon briefings where they tell you very little often, and you have to really, you know, walk the halls looking for information. Yes, it's great training for a reporter. But I think for someone like me who wasn't necessarily taken seriously as a legitimate person and journalist, I think when I came into the Today Show, the fact that I had covered the Pentagon did give me automatic street cred with people like Brian Gumbel.
Oh, absolutely. And when they were talking about Fred's tenure there yesterday, I can see why he became a very successful editor and you became a very successful anchor because you just can't bluff it. Her short question, Katie Couric, before we go to our first break, you did a lot of summer concerts at the Today Show. What was your favorite?
My favorite summer concert?
At the Today Show.
Oh, I don't know. I love Sting, so I've always loved Sting. And, of course, Beyonce, Destiny's Child, the precursor of Beyonce. I brought my daughters to that concert, so I scored big points with them.
That's the giveaway. That's the poker tell. That's the one you remember and that they will be talking about. I'll be right back with Katie Couric. I'm enjoying the book. I'm loving the book. In fact, going there is in Audible, which I recommend highly, but it's also available at bookstores everywhere at Amazon.com. Go and get it. It is the mortal lock Christmas present for the woman in your life and men who want to actually understand the women in your life. Don't go anywhere. I'll be back with Katie Couric in just a moment. We have sponsors on the show, like ReliefFactor.com. I hold it up for you. And Katie knows breaks. That's what I love about interviewing a professional broadcaster is they understand commercial breaks. ReliefFactor.com. I'm taking with me to Minnesota today. I just looked at that weather report. It is going to be mighty awful. And I'm going to bring extra relief factor, I think, for the people I find who are holding the doors against the wind. It's going to be pretty brutal. But if you're coming to the debate, I will be there. Please come out to it. AM 1280 The Patriot will be broadcasting the debate tonight. And I'll be right back with more with Katie Couric, talking about going there, a New York Times bestseller. I recommend the Audible book. I'm going to get to my questions next, America. Don't go anywhere. You're listening to The Hugh Hewitt Show with Katie Couric.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Prison Fellowship's Angel Tree Summer Camps. Click on the banner at hughhewitt.com.
Trending now on The Mike Gallagher Show.
I digress. So anyway, I'm watching CBS Sunday Morning. They got a weather guy on there. Derek, let's see if we can find this. He says, well, these tornadoes that hit Kentucky and Arkansas and all these terrible, horrible storms and people killed in the candle factory and people killed in the Amazon shipping facility. Now, it could have been climate change, but there are reasons that it might be climate change, but here are reasons where it's not climate change. The guy was like standing there sort of tortured. Because you know he's being pressured. Is this climate change? Or is it not? And it's like, can you just deal with the devastation? I've been to a scene of a tornado destruction. I went to Greenberg, Kansas, a number of years ago. We fundraised for the victims there. It's unlike anything you'll ever, it's like Hiroshima. It looks like when a nuclear bomb goes off, like an atom bomb. The whole town, just all you see are trees, tree limbs. And it's just awful to watch, to see. And our prayers and our prayer for God's healing and comfort with so many people who are suffering. Can you leave the climate change crap alone, please? For just what? Why are you fixated, lefties, progressives? Here's Cut 11. Here's Biden himself.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high-rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt talking to Katie Couric, whose great new memoir, Going There, is on bestseller lists in bookstores everywhere. It's the perfect Christmas present for people who love good books, and especially for people of a certain age and for young people. So that's everybody. People of a certain age will recognize that girl. And I love the asides, Katie. They're terrific in this book, and so I thought I'd throw that in.
I appreciate the musical choices, Hugh.
Yeah, well, I'm not going to play Helen Reddy. That was too obvious. I did, however, discover you're a tri-delt. Now, I bused tables for the tryouts when I was at law school in Michigan. They were very mean. Were they nicer at the University of Virginia?
Of course they were nice. I was a tryout for 1 year because I lived on the lawn at UVA, and I couldn't bear living eating my meals at Newcomb Hall, the cafeteria, one more year. But I had a lot of friends in that sorority. It was a great group of women, and they were very nice. And I'm sorry the ones at Michigan weren't.
Oh, they were terrible, and I've always held it against. I want to talk to you about John and Jeff and about your mom. John, your dad, Jeff, the wonderful producer, and boy wonder, Jeff Zucker, who I know from the debates in 2016. And then I want to talk about your mom as well. Let's talk with John, your dad. He sounds like the perfect dad, Katie. Always encouraging, with limits, taking you to NPC. I think you heard Louis Evans. We might have been in the church at the same time. We
lived yes. Louis Evans, I think the one, the National Presbyterian Church was Brian, and I'm trying to remember his last name. He was a guest minister from, I think, New York Presbyterian at National Presbyterian, and he was an amazing minister, just an incredible speaker. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Well, there's Ben Patterson from California. I don't know the New Yorkers. I knew Louis pretty well. We went a lot. I'm a Catholic, but I would go with my Presbyterian wife, and I do today, and I have a great pastor today. Kitty, are you still a churchgoer at all?
Yes, I go. You know, I haven't, you know, because of COVID, it's been pretty tricky. But I belong to Brick Church here in New York City. I started to go to Marble Collegiate because I thought it was interesting and a little more of a diverse group going there than Brick Church. But
did you know that Marble Collegiate is where President Trump attended? I talked to him last week in this hour, and we talked about Norman Vincent Peale and Marble Collegiate. Did you know that?
Yes, I know. I know that's where he attended, and it's a really interesting church, very into social justice. They do, you know, they talk about current events at that church in a way that really resonates with me. I remember being frustrated when I went to my church after the shooting in Dunblane, Scotland. Of course, the seat of the press, you know, the Presbyterian.
The
yeah, exactly. And I was really just dismayed that no one talked about it in the sermon. And I like places that talk about what's going on in the world and give you some perspective. But I really enjoy church just because I like feeling the community there, feeling sort of with other people. And as I wrote in my book, you know, I like the almost the familiarity of singing things like Praise God from Whom All Blessings Flow and things like that. And
it's family. It's an extended family. Now, your dad is such a remarkable dad that I think I told you when I set up the interview, I want people to understand you can be a great father on a budget and as a reporter and as a PR guy. Did you deliver a eulogy? Did you have to speak it?
I did.
How'd you do?
Of course I was a mess, but, you know, I love my eulogy. I keep all the eulogies from, like, my mom's funeral, my dad's, from Jay's, from my sister Emily, because boy, it really does give you the essence of the love you had for that person and what made them so special in your life. And yes, I did the eulogy. One of my favorite parts of that book was and my relationship with my dad was when we were walking out of his hospital room, my brother and I. And I said, Johnny, I guess we need to write Dad's obituary. And he said, oh, Katie, he's already written it.
Yeah, he was a newspaper man, so of course he would have. I am curious, though, Katie, when you look back at this, do you think he's a role model for other dads? Like Jay is for young husbands of pregnant women. I think Jay gets medals for this.
Yes, Jay was very progressive in terms of the division of labor and what a huge help he was. He was an equal partner in every way. And, you know, Melinda Gates writes about the fact that women do an average of 7 more years.
You mentioned that,
Of housework and, you know, and taking care of kids. And Jay was such an equal partner. I think you're right. He's a great role model. And, of course, you know, I think my dad hung the moon, Hugh. So, of course, I think he's a great role model for Bob.
Well, it comes through. It just, it, when he calls you up after interviews and says you've gone too far with the safe sex demonstration or you are making how much, that's actually my favorite. You're making how much, I got that a lot from my dad, too, when I was making more as a lawyer. Don't go anywhere, America, except to my podcast, The Interview with Katie Couric. I'm going to talk to Katie for 10 more minutes about Jeff Zucker, about discovering that she's Jewish, and about going there. Her best-selling book, available at Amazon.com. I recommend the Audible version. So does my wife. So does my daughter-in-law. But either way, it's the go-to Christmas present, Going There by Katie Couric. Go over to The Interview with Hugh Hewitt for the rest of today's conversation with Katie. I'll be back on Friday. I'm going to Minnesota after the show to do a debate tonight. I hope I make it back, given the weather forecast. Talk to you Friday. With Katie Couric. Katie, the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt is one quarter Jewish. Her grandfather was Jewish. And I was sitting in the room when her sister